On November 8th, 1981, the Sunday New York Times weighed about 4 pounds, give or take a couple of ounces. It included 10 sections and 3 supplements. Those 10 sections and 3 supplements added up to 712 pages. We have with the Sunday New York Times a weekly reminder that the American economy lives and runs on waste. And the New York Times reflects it and utilizes it, and in its own practices carries on the same wasteful practices. Let us examine what we have in this massive 712 pages, which would be, if put in a book form, a very heavy tome indeed. The first section, 88 pages or so, in 2 parts, it's difficult to find the news. 3/4 of the materials are advertisements, and the news, which we may get back to, doesn't add up to very much, considering that you have an entire world to cover. But let's pay some attention to the paper's part that has a very national renown. Let's examine the New York Times Sunday Magazine section. 168 pages in itself, a very good size paperback, to say the least. And what does the New York Times Magazine do? It gives us an agenda of what to think about, and it also gives us a standard around which to organize our lives. Let's see what it includes. I counted, excluding the special features, 8 articles. Now, that in itself is not as simple as you might think, because just to get through these 168 pages is a pretty deceptive business. Getting, in fact, to the very first article, excluding, again, 1 or 2 one-page features, one has to plow through 35 pages of crystalware. One has to plow through bathing suit ads, all kinds of expensive liquors, all kinds of clothing, all kinds of household gadgets, certainly the automobile ads. Certainly, of course, there is the omnipresent types of clothing materials and the luxury goods appealing to the influentials who read this paper. But when you finally get to the first article, it's about, in its own title, how stable are the Saudis?
Well, let's take a look inside these romance novels and see just how they get managed to put so many of them out that say the same thing in what seems like or is supposed to be so many different ways. The fact that every major publishing house has maybe 6 or 7 lines, and they're like historical. Some are supposed to be like for the sexually liberated woman, the career woman, the teenager. But basically, every single one of them is based on a formula that goes back way before paperback romances were ever published. And this is a paperback version of really the classic romance novel that they all take off from. This is about a young girl, Eleanor Rochdale, once well-to-do, now must earn her living as a governess. But strange circumstances take her to the ancestral home of Lord Carlyon, who asks her, etc., etc. Now, what these are all about is a young girl, a young virgin, usually penniless, having to go to work, and she meets up with this aristocratic lord, and he's always very craggy, and he's very mysterious, and he has a bad personality, he's temperamental, he's arrogant. The kind of names that they give these people are like Damien Savage or Devil Haggard. These are real names. And the plot always involves the same thing. The girl manages to break through this obnoxious guy's exterior and find underneath beating a little teddy bear of a loving, adorable man that only she can bring out. And they fall madly in love, and he marries her, and they live happily ever after. Now, there are two things about this that are really interesting. One is that what this is based on is something that's kind of sad about what happens in sexist societies, which is that men and women do live in very different worlds, and that men, in fact, traditional masculinist men, if you want to call it that, tend to be very insensitive, somewhat overbearing and arrogant, and a total mystery to women who are brought up to think and feel very differently. Well, the trick of these books is that they make you feel as though there's something really thrilling and sexy about what's basically a very unpleasant situation between men and women. And even more than that, they make you feel that what this young girl does to get through to this guy is sort of represents a kind of a sexual power that she has, which is the only kind of power that women are supposed to have in this kind of literature and in this kind of society. And yet, when you read these books real carefully, the power is extremely misleading, because what always happens is that she's the one that gets swept away and is passively yielding to him and is overpowered by passion. So that's the standard. Now,
the truth is something altogether different, and that's where the problem lies, because the manipulative aspect of a magazine like, excuse me, a newspaper, this is being contested in higher courts right now, a newspaper like the National Enquirer, is that it manipulates our desire, our sickness, our physical sickness, our mental illness, our desperation, our disgust. It manipulates it, it injects stories about UFOs. Baffled experts claim UFOs directly related to angels in heaven. I mean, a lot of things are true, but unfortunately, we have our doubts about that one. It manipulates our perverse desires. It makes us buy this stupid piece of magazine instead of organizing the movement we need to overthrow the... I mean, we can't do it. It's obvious they're stronger than we are. It's decaying. It's falling apart. Punks are not painting themselves green because they have spiritual inner peace, folks. Let's face it. So what I'd like to leave you with this evening is perhaps the knowledge that there's someone as crazy as you are who's on television.
You see it?